Yes, then we'll start. Respected Principal Nalini Ambad Ma'am, guest of honor, beloved teachers, and all students, a very good afternoon to everyone. I, Sushmita Avinash of second year LLB, welcome you all on behalf of DESS Sri Navalmal Firodia Law College to the third day of Krutadnatya, 5-day alumni lecture series organized by the Seminar Department and the Alumni Department. We are grateful to have our alumni joining us for this session. I welcome Advocate Yashpal Purohit sir to join us today. I am profoundly delighted to take an opportunity to introduce our guest speaker for today's session, Advocate Yashpal Purohit sir. Sir has completed his graduation in BSL LLB from our esteemed college in the year 2013. Sir has been practicing since 2013 in Pune District Court and Bombay High Court. In the year 2017-18, Sir was given special charge of POXO Court, that is Protection of Children from Sexual Offence, by the District Legal Service Authority, Pune. In the year 2019, Sir was awarded as Best Zonal Panel Lawyer for the West Zone of India by ex and current CJI of Supreme Court. He has dealt with more than 2,000 POXO cases at various stages. He has also dealt with 3,000 cases of convicts and have helped them in filing appeal in High Court and Supreme Court. Sir has also assisted the court to formulate new policies in POXO Act, and he is also a jail visiting panel lawyer. Sir is also a philanthropist. He regularly makes donations for schooling of victims in POXO. We are grateful to Yashpal sir for accepting our invitation and marking his presence here. Now, I request Yashpal sir to address the gathering and cast the light of his knowledge upon us. His comments are quintessential for the student who want to be like him one day. Sir, you have motivated us all enough by being a role model. We would be delighted with your expertise and knowledge in every way possible. So, without consuming any time, I would like to call upon sir to enlighten us with his words of true wisdom. Thank you, sir. We welcome you all.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the opportunity, first of all. This is a very kind gesture by the Law College. They have created this program wherein we can all share our knowledge, the limited knowledge that we have, obviously. And the second thing is, before I start with this lecture, it is, as we all understand, it is Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act. So it is called POXO Act, not POSCO Act. So this is the first and foremost thing, because many people I have seen, they state it as POSCO Act, but it is POXO Act, because C comes first of children and then sexual offences. Now, starting with the lecture, I would like to tell all of you why this particular act was enacted in 2012. It is because before 2012, there was only Section 375 and 376, which used to govern the cases of child abuse. However, the impact of that child abuse was such that the legislature thought it would be best to have a separate act altogether to understand and to punish the offenders of the offenders who have committed this act. It is beautifully drafted 46 sections only act. There are 46 sections only, out of which section 3 to 80 are the sections wherein different definitions of sexual assault, penetrative sexual assault, aggravated sexual assault have been given. Punishment for sexual harassment has also been given in that. Plus, there are sections in the POXO Act which state, section 13 to section 15, regarding the child pornography. And it is now, there is a punishment to it. If at all you circulate, if at all you store, if at all you forget to delete any child pornography which is there in your electronic devices, it is a punishable offense. If you try to circulate it, if you try to post it somewhere, it is an offense. Now, going ahead, there are before that, after Section 18, there are certain procedures and miscellaneous applications that are there in the Act, which suggest and which say that how the court should function in POXO courts. There is a specially designated sessions judge who sits in the POXO court. He acts as a judicial magistrate, even though he's a sessions judge, and he takes remand. He is in charge of hearing all the bail applications which are filed by the accused in the cases. Then comes the special public prosecutors, who are specifically appointed to deal in the cases wherein at the later stage, when the child is supposed to depose before the honorable court, then the public prosecutors are specially trained. They have been given training to assist them to speak before the court, because the atmosphere of the court, it is little different, because the children have never seen the atmosphere of the court. They get scared, they don't speak. And then if they don't speak, it is beneficial to the accused person who escapes from the law. And there are many guidelines which have been issued by the Act itself in order to have a child-friendly courtrooms, child-friendly police stations. There are special rooms in the police stations wherein the child can depose. The police officers have to be in plain clothes while taking the statement of the victim girl. The victim girl is entitled for food, shelter and clothing if she is victim of POXO Act. The DLSA, the District Legal Aid Services Authority, provides free legal aid, because it has been given in Section 7 of... Hello? It has been given in Section Rule 7 of Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Rule 2020, wherein the legal aid is provided to the victim girl if she needs, or she needs any help regarding this. Then there is an entire set of form that is called Form A, which states and which suggests that there are 15 parameters in the form, wherein the name of the victim girl is given, the name of the police superintendent is given, the protection is given to the victim girl in the cases, she has been provided with the medical help. In medical help, her entire body checkup, including sexually transmitted diseases, pregnancy, HIV, every test related to penetrative sexual assault is done on the victim girl, which is free of cost. And if at all the girl is in need of admission in the hospital, the charges are borne by the government or the authorities which are acting upon it. The district collectors and superintendent of police's numbers are given to the victim girl. If at all they face any problem, they can directly contact them or the person who has been designated by the DM or superintendent of police. They can contact them directly. The foremost is that the names and her identity, her parents' name, her address, her age, her school is now the police, or the, as per the recent judgment of Honorable Bombay High Court Aurangabad bench, Tanpure versus State, they have stated that no names, the identity of the victim should be kept completely confidential. Her name is to be referred as either X, or in many cases in Maharashtra, it has been referred as Nirbhaya or ABC. The second thing in the to keep the confidential identity of the victim girl confidential, they make an application to the DLSA, wherein as per the DLSA rules and Manodhairya scheme, they get compensation firstly of 30,000, and as per the severity of the offense, the compensation can go up to 10 lakh rupees. If at all the victim girl results from her statement in the court, and if at all the DLSA has given her any compensation, the DLSA has the power to recover that compensation because the victim girl has turned hostile in the court. These are all general principles of POCSO Act. So while dealing in the POCSO Act or while dealing in the cases of POCSO Act, I have seen this act is enacted for the people specifically, because I have been working in this field for 4 years. I have spoken to many accused persons who have committed this act. And after going through certain conversations, I have got to know that I have spoken to a person who had committed a rape on the victim girl who was aged only 3 years. She was 3-year-old victim girl. And just to understand the psychology behind the, you know, the act, why he has been doing this, because he was absconding for many days and then finally he was caught. It was said that his mental status was not right. He himself was sexually assaulted by some other person, a guy. And after that, he went on spree of sexually assaulting girl. The worst part of that case was he had actually killed the victim girl, a 3-year-old victim girl, while doing the act. So this act and this legislature is enacted to curb the mentality of these persons. These persons are the pesticides who can simply go on and on in the society, and they can commit whatever they want in the society. So the punishment in this is up to death. The minimum punishment of rape under 12-year-old girl is 20 years. Above 12, it is minimum 10. It can go up to the life depending upon the case's situation. So basically, the act of POCSO Act is created for those who commit crime. This is only one case. In total, in Pune district, almost 5 to 6 POCSO cases are registered every day. Not all the cases are of, 3-year-old or 4-year-old girl. Some girls are 17 years and 11 months, but still, as per the definition of child, they are still minors, and the POCSO Act is applied to them. Thereafter, there are many things in the POCSO Act as to Section 29 and 30. It is for the presumption of commission of an offence, presumption of commission of certain act. So if the victim girl is saying that she has been sexually assaulted by the accused, then it is presumed that she is sexually assaulted if the accused fails to come up with plausible explanation as to why he has been falsely implicated in the offense. Because the sole testimony of the victim girl is enough to prosecute and convict the accused person, even if all the other witnesses fail to inspire the confidence from the side of the prosecution. So you being a first year student, these are the heavy words that I've been using. So I'm not going into the details of the POCSO Act, but as a first year student, you have to understand why any act comes into existence. So if you read, because since we have a limited time, if you read, before 2012, the child sexual abuse cases has gone up to 90,000 or 90 lakhs. So therefore, the government thought that this is the time and this is the need to have a special act to curb the cases. And thereafter, after 2012, there is a considerable decline in the cases. However, like I said, there are few people who have notion specifically that HIV can be cured if he intercourses with a girl who is still a child. So this is the major concern and major part which I have seen while visiting the jails, that they find that this is the cure to their HIV, because there is no medicine which can completely cure the HIV. So this is the cure, and they sexually assault the minor girls. The second thing is, it is just because their family is away and they have nothing to do. I have seen cases wherein father has raped his own daughter. The daughter got pregnant, but they, due to fear of embarrassment and many other social barriers, the girl did not say anything to her mother till she was 6 months pregnant. Thereafter, the girl could not abort the child because she had already exceeded the number of weeks which were permitted, and the baby boy was delivered out of that entire incident. The father was convicted for life. However, the mentality of the child was that she is my blood and I can do whatever that I want with that victim girl. The second case was that her own uncle had committed rape, and since she had already known his uncle, he had thrown her upside down into the water till she died. And thereafter, he approached the police stating that, "I would like to report a case wherein my niece is missing." And he had also told her father, who was his real brother, that your daughter is missing and we should find her and do something about it. The police, after searching for 5 days, they got to know that the baby girl was last seen with this person, and they arrested, and he eventually confessed the offense. He's still in the jail, but these are the different types of, different criteria of people, those who are in the society, those who are not educated. Some people are educated. I have a case wherein he is an engineer. He had filed a divorce with his wife. And since the custody of that victim girl was with him, he took him to his hometown somewhere in Ahmednagar. And there he was raping her for a continuous number of days before she could tell it to anybody. After that, when the victim girl's mother came to receive her after her custody ended with her father, she narrated the entire ordeal to her mother and she filed a complaint. So this is the tendency in the society that we are, the POXO is looking for, basically, the act is looking for. The tendency in the society is such that if at all the example is not set in a proper way, these things keep on happening every now and then, because the cases that we see, no relation I have seen that has been left out of POXO. The brother has committed rape on her own real sister. Father has committed rape on his own daughter. Father has committed rape on his own son. Then grandfather has committed rape on his granddaughter. So there are, you name any relation in POXO that has happened. And when it comes to this, when it comes to reporting of an offense, the reporting is the most difficult thing for any victim girl to go ahead and report the cases in the police station. Because first of all, it is social stigma. Second of all, they are not only going to say things which his father or his brother or any other person must have done to her, but his father is going to be taken away for considerable period of time after registering of an FIR. And he is the only earning member of the family. And therefore, the cases are not reported. This is what I've seen in the last 4 years. That agar mere hi baap, once the victim girl in the court said that if mere hi baap ko leke jayenge, to meri char behne aur meri maa sab mar jayenge. So this is what the things that we hear in the court, and that is what happens. So therefore, Section 3 to 18 have specifically been enacted for the punishments. And in 2018, Criminal Law Amendment Act in 2018, it is now compulsory for the accused person to send notice to the victim girl after he applies for the bail. If the victim girl is 16 years and less. Why 16 years is because there are certain judgments of Honorable Bombay High Court, which is in consonance with Varadarajan versus State. I hope this is a landmark judgment and you should read it, because the contents of it are very elaborate, and you will understand why this judgment is referred in the bail applications which have been decided by the Honorable Bombay High Court. There is Aniruddha Yadav versus State. It is a bail application which has been decided by Honorable Justice S.K. Shinde on 13th of July, I suppose, or 16th of July, wherein the 16 year and above girls are capable of understanding the consequences of the act of which they are going. Because the papers, the police papers, the FIR, it was stated by the victim girl herself that she on her own had left the house because the parents were against the marriage. At that tender age, he had nothing to do with it. So keeping these persons behind the bar is pre-trial detention is not at all necessary. And in that case, the bail was granted. So why 16 has been the mark of 16 years has been set is because prior to that, the victim girl has to be heard before giving bail to the accused, because in many of times it has been revealed that the boys take away girls, stating that they want to marry them, and after they elope together, the boy usually sells the victim girl to some brothel, or he keeps her at some house or a room where she has to slog, she has to work day in and day out, or she or he sells him to some rich people who can keep her as a maid. So after considering all these things, after she is rescued from the clutches of the accused, it is necessary to hear the victim girl. And if she is not, if she is really the victim girl, has suffered the ordeal, the real ordeal which only the victim girl can state before the court. The police papers does not include everything, but what is her actual state of mind, current state of mind, and if she has any threats or if she has received any threats, if she feels that if the accused comes out on bail, he is likely to inflict any injury to her. So therefore, these notices are issued. I'll just state a few sections. There are section 4, wherein section 4.1, wherein the punishment is minimum punishment is of 1 year, 10 years, and it can go till the imprisonment of life. Then after the amendment, there are certain sections which have been added in section 376, that is 376 AB and DA, wherein the small, very small, when I say child, child is of 5 years, 4 years, 3 months, because wherein there are certain cases wherein, like I just gave an example of an accused who thought that his HIV can be cured. In that incident, the victim girl was only of 3 months. And therefore, section 4.2, which is there, the minimum sentence is 20 years. The minimum, and it can go till life if the victim girl is 12 years and less. Then there is section 6.1, wherein 20 years remains static. It remains. The minimum sentence is 20 years. It can go to imprisonment for life. And if at all the Honorable Court finds that the act is very heinous, it is a repeated act, it is a gang rape, 376D. So the punishment can go up to death. So this creates a fear in the society, because the names of the victim girls are not circulated in the newspapers or the electronic media, but the punishment is circulated. That so and so person has been sentenced to 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. He has been sentenced to life imprisonment. So all these things matter eventually, because in order to curb the sexual offenses on a child, it is very important for all of us to understand that this is an act which has been enacted specifically for the people, those who are mentally incapable. And when I say mentally incapable in the sense that they don't understand the consequences, they don't respect the children, or they don't respect the women in general, women in society in general. So while dealing with the POXO cases, we have to understand, we have to go into the details of each and every case, wherein why he has done it. If he is a if he is a pesticide to the society, like I've just said, and he said many of the offenses they are committed while they are under the influence of alcohol or any other drug, that they don't understand what they have committed. So one of the accused during his remand, he told me that he was so drunk that he thought his daughter is his wife and he committed rape on her. And he not only did it once, he did it every night when he was drunk. So these are the cases in POXO usually that come up that you read. And the cases, why these cases are reported by the papers. I have seen, I read almost 4 or 5 papers every day. In each and every paper, there is always a column with the name of an accused, that he has been arrested under the sections of POXO Act, he has been arrested under the sections of this Act, where the child is related. Because in society, it's very important to understand who are these people from whom the parent should be aware of. He can be a watchman, he can be a driver, he can be a family friend, he can be a business partner. So there is no strata to it. All these people, they can simply formulate, they can get acquainted with the victim girls, and they do this act just I have had one of my accused who told me that he has sexually assaulted a victim girl just for fun. So all these things for which this act has been enacted, the intention behind this act is to curb all these things. There are specifically sections which state that the media people should not give the names of the victim girl or the family members of the victim girl, which can identify the victim girl. So it is little difficult for her to roam around in the area or in the society. Now the comes why this sections have been added regarding the recording statement of the child, the victim. The statement is recorded in the child-friendly manner when the victim girl is really ready to speak her ordeal, because usually it has been told to either to her mother or her grandmother or to any of the close friends. In some cases, the victim girls are both deaf and dumb. So they reveal this incident to teachers who can understand the sign language. Those who can understand the body language of the victim girl, which changes after the act. And her statement is recorded by the police officer in the plain clothes, like I have stated. Her statement is again recorded before the judicial magistrate first class, who records her statement under section 164 subclause 5, wherein whatever her ordeal is, she states before the magistrate. So while the case comes for hearing or for the trial, she, even if she is persuaded to resign from her statement or to turn hostile, there is always an added layer of protection to the prosecution that this victim had deposed the same deposition before the learned JMFC, and who comes to the court and deposes before the sessions court that the victim girl had deposed in this matter, and whatever that the statement is, it has been deposed before me. So this helps the court to reach to a conclusion wherein if the accused is pressurizing the victim girl, the court can still convict him. Then there are various procedures as to how the statement of the victim girl should be recorded in court and in the police station. Like I stated, there is a different room in the police station wherein there are some toys, or there are some soft toys, or there are some child-friendly atmospheric things in that room. So the victim girl's mind is little diverted. She is relaxed to a certain extent, and she reveals her ordeal in the court. The learned JMFCs are told to isolate the court completely. They are at the actual procedure is the learned JMFC comes down from the dais. He removes his gown. He removes his coat. He sits before the victim girl. He takes a pen and a paper, and whatever the victim girl states, he writes it down word to word as per the victim girl's statement, and takes her signature or the guardian's signature under it. The family member, either of the family members, are allowed to be inside the courtroom when the victim girl is deposing. This is both the victim. This is both in police station and in the learned JMFC court. And the third thing is the victim girl has to come to court only thrice. That is once before the police. If at all certain things are to be done or certain statements are to be taken, she comes to the court at that point of time. Second statement before the judicial magistrate, first class, 164.5 statement. And third is when she deposes before the Honorable Sessions Court, when the trial starts. So practically the victim girl only comes before the court thrice. So she doesn't have to go through that mental trauma every now and then, that whatever that has happened with her, she doesn't have to state that statement before anybody, before the judge, before the police repeatedly. There are specifically designated courts. We have two specifically designated courts. And currently, there is a separate extra joint district judges court, which has been set up all over the India, wherein the learned and honorable retired judges are called back because they already know the procedure. They have retired and considering all the factors, they are called back. They act as a regular district judges and they fast track the cases which have been held because of the pendency. So the cases are transferred to that court. That court sees that the trials are conducted expeditiously. The trials are getting over within a month so that after filing of charge sheet, that is after the Criminal Amendment Act, before that it was 90 days for filing of the charge sheet. However, after the amendment, the days have come down to 60. So after charge sheet is filed in the court, that is under section 173 of CRPC, these charge sheets are transferred to court, wherein the accused is summons, his charge is framed, and on the very next day, the victim girl comes to the court, he deposes as per her statement. And I have seen that a trial has ended in 20 days. A trial has ended in a month, wherein the accused was convicted for 30 years, 20 years, or more than that, for a life as well. It is because of these fast-track courts, the specially designated courts, the POXO trials are getting ahead, and the victim girls are actually getting justice within a stipulated period time for which this act was enacted. The powers of the special courts are they're limitless, to be very honest. They can summon the accused. They can summon the police officers if they are lacking in their duties. If the person who is incapable of representing himself through his private advocate, then the court can have its the court can write to DLSA. And the DLSA appoints their panel advocates to deal with the cases so that the speedy justice is given either to the accused if the case is false or to the victim girl. There are certain guidelines which have been issued by the state. Like I've just told you, the cases are generally to be finished within month time. However, there are so much of pendency. In many cases, the victim girls are from different states. So they file a case in Pune and they relocate to some different state. So they are unable to come. In most of the cases wherein the victim girls are 17 years and 11 months, the parents of that victim girl they get her married to some other person or to some other state. And the family usually doesn't know about all these things. So they either they result from their statement or they don't come to the court at all. However, before the victim girl's statement, no POXO trial can conclude because she is the only witness and she, upon her testimony, the case's final result is decided. In sort of these 46 sections, the procedural part of POXO courts, the punitive part in which for which the POXO Act has been enacted, the amendments, timely amendments have been done. All these things are settled and stated in the Act. The Act, due to constraint of time, the Act cannot be taught to you over the, you know, because it is over the lecture, because it is more of a procedural act, because you have to practically understand and see why Section 3, Section 4 have been specifically enacted, why they have been written in certain way, why section, not only why sexual harassment has been included in the POXO Act, wherein there is sexual, already Section 7 is there when there is a penetrative sexual assault. Sexual harassment that comes, even if you have been stalking, because IPC's Section 354, all parts, 509, and IT Act, POXO Act, they are all interconnected. Because if accused is stalking some girl over a phone, if he is stating, if he is telling the victim girl to send her explicit pictures over the period of time, even if the victim girl or the girl is saying that she doesn't want to do it, he threatens the victim girl sends the picture, then the accused person tells the victim girl that he will, you know, viral all these pictures if his sexual demands are not met. However, there is a difference in this. If the sexual demands are not met, the victim girl can file complaint under Section 354D, 354C, 354, just for stalking, just for, you know, outraging her modesty in certain way, making any gestures. So all these things are interlinked. And at that time, Section 11 and Section 12 of POXO Act are usually attracted. The sexual assault wherein the victim girl is not sexually, penetratively sexually assaulted, but she has been touched completely inappropriately by the person who is twice her age. When there is absolutely no necessity for that accused person to be in contact with that victim girl, still he urges, the victim girl is, there's a ladki ja rahi hai road se, agar if she is a minor, so peeche se jaake haath laga dega ya uska haath pakad lega ya usko kuch bolega, or he proposes her even though knowing that she is a minor. For all these purpose, sexual harassment, sexual assault cases, holding a hand, touching victim girl on her private parts inappropriately, all this comes under, see, there are basically there is a chapter 2 in POXO Act wherein there are five columns that they have made. First is penetrative sexual assault. Then the second is aggravated penetrative sexual assault. Then comes that sexual assault, sexual assault. The sexual assault, aggravated sexual assault. When I say normal sexual assault, it doesn't include any penetrative sexual act. However, the victim girl is sexually assaulted by touching her inappropriately or by doing certain act which will, violate her privacy. Then the third and last part comes is sexual harassment, wherein, like I just said, a boy is stalking a minor girl while she is on her way to school, and this happens every now and then. The psychology of the victim girl is of that it happens that victim girl stops going to the school. she academically, her graph is curved toward downwards. So parents get a little worried. They ask, because as per the act or as per the sections which are there, the accused has not touched a victim girl. The accused has not done anything. The accused has not penetratively sexually assaulted the victim girl. But he has, in certain way, affected the victim girl just by following her, not talking to her, and just keep on harassing her in some or the other way. So therefore, this A, B, C, D, and E are the columns which are given in Chapter 2 of the POPSO Act, wherein it has been elaborately stated as to what are the parameters of each section and what can be the punishment, what should be the punishment for the act which has been done by the accused. Now, this act specifically includes Section 13 to Section 15 is for use of child pornography for any purpose, circulating amongst, the simple example is, even if you receive any child pornography on one of the WhatsApp groups that you have, and if you fail to report it to the appropriate authority, that is cyber cell authority or the concerned police station, that I have received this and I'm deleting it, but before deleting it, it was my duty as a citizen to report it. And if you don't report it, that is also an offense. The person using a child for child pornography, he himself is not doing anything to a child, but he is using a child to make pornographic videos. That itself is an offense. And storing, circulating, doing everything, storing, circulating, thereafter exhibiting the child pornography wherever they can, on Facebook, on WhatsApp, on Instagram, Twitter. This itself is an offense. Anything which sexually exploits a child and a video of it is made, and whoever it is involved in that entire process is also made as an accused. This is also a punishable offense. Whoever abets that offense, the abettor is also held, and he has been tried for the same sections as if he is the principal offender because he has abetted that offense. Now, after all this, I suppose the POPSO Act here is completely covered. So if you have any questions, I would like to answer them.
If any student have any question for sir, they can put in the chat box so sir can address them.
I'm online from my phone, so if somebody can read the question, that would be really appreciated.
Sir, as of now, we don't have any questions. If we don't have any questions, we can move forward to the vote of thanks.
Yes, please.
Okay. Ma'am, shall I move to vote of thanks?
Sushmita, I think there is one question.
Yeah, I just saw it. Yeah. So the question is, does it take a toll on your mental health, like hearing of such atrocious cases?
To be very honest, at first it did. After, like I told you, a three-year-old victim girl was killed because the accused had banged her head on the coach of the railway bogie. So after hearing these cases, obviously the mind gets disturbed. However, we as an advocates, or we like doctors, we cannot stop at a certain point, and we have to go on. So It does take, but as you progress in your practice, you learn to handle and understand the things which are there.
I hope it answers Ashwati's question. Any more questions, student? Sir, we haven't received any more questions.
No problem.
Vote of thanks then.
Yes.
I deem it a great honor to propose the vote of thanks to all who have helped us in making the webinar such a resounding success. First of all, I would like to propose hearty vote of thanks to our distinguished speaker, Advocate Yashpal Purohit Sir, for making excellent presentation and making the webinar interesting and meaningful. Thank you, sir, for very interesting and thought-provoking address. I would like to express our profound gratitude to Dr. Sharad Kunte Sir, Chairman of Deccan Education Society, Advocate Nitin Apte Sir, Chairman CDC of DES SNFLC, Assistant Professor Nalini Ambad Ma'am, Officiating Principal DES SNFLC, all the faculty members and the non-teaching staff. This event would not have been possible without their support and guidance. Finally, the wonderful students, thank you so much for paying your valuable attention and being an enthusiastic audience. We thank you for being with us this evening. It has been an event gardening great pleasure for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, Yashpal sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Yashpal.